happy Father's Day. We are celebrating Father's Day on today. We first of all want to say congratulations to everyone who got baptized on yesterday. And let me say, the baptismal candidates are celebrities of today. This morning, I think about 900 people had watched the baptism. So, praise God for the people who are interested in seeing who's getting baptized. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So we're excited. So those who did not make it to the pool, see me after service. All right. Father's Day, I want to tell you a little bit about the history of Father's Day. The first known Father's Day service occurred at the Williams Memorial Methodist Episcopal Church in Fairmont, West Virginia, on July 5th, 1908. However, that was because one of the members there asked the pastor if there could be a Sunday service to honor fathers. And so she was missing her own dad, who died in 1896. And so she wanted a service in remembrance of other fathers. There were about 200 fathers who had died in the Monongah mining explosion. And so she wanted a service for that. And so this was the first known Father's Day service, a service that honored fathers. And then later, it was, I need to skip some of this. Later, it was asked that there be a celebration in the town, and in the town where she was. And so this particular lady, Mrs. Dodd, asked the Ministerial Association, the YMCA, if they would celebrate Father's Day. And so she chose the 5th of June because that was her father's birthday. And so the minister said they needed more time. Y'all know the ministers always need time to get their sermons together. So they said they needed time to prepare their sermons for this unexpected subject of fathers. And so therefore, they asked that it be moved in Spokane, Washington, if it be moved to June 19th, which was the third Sunday in June, because that gave them time to get their sermons together for Father's Day. So after this particular area celebrated Father's Day, then other towns in the state of Washington began to celebrate fathers also. And so it became widely spread. And so, however, even though lots of people were celebrating it, it did not come before Congress in a bill until 1913. And in spite of the encouragement of President Woodrow Wilson, it did not pass. Y'all know stuff ain't gonna get past Congress. You gotta bring it around a couple of times. So in 1966, now that was 1913, so in 1966, Lyndon Johnson issued a proclamation designating the third Sunday in June to honor fathers. However, that was 1966, so it wasn't until 1972, when President Richard Nixon was president, that Father's Day was signed into law, declaring it be celebrated annually on the third Sunday in June. So since 1972, it has been celebrated on the third Sunday in June since. So we wanted you to have a little history of Father's Day. So this time we have a poem for you that Deacon Sylvester Stokes will read for us.
Bishop, thanks for the history. Didn't know. Happy Father's Day to all that are fathers and that serve in the role of father. A Father's Day poem. A careful man I ought to be. A little fellow follows me. I do not dare go astray, for fear he'll go the same self way. I cannot once escape his eyes. Wherever he sees, he'll try. Like me, he says he's going to be the little chap who follows me. He thinks that I am good and fine. He believes in every word of mine. The base of me, he must not see. The little chap who follows me. I must remember as I go through summer's fun and winter's snow, and building for the years to be, the little chap who follows me.
True sentiment of young people who look at the fathers and try to do what they see the fathers doing. Thank you so much. So at this time we will have Brother Dijon Tucker, who would like to do a solo on behalf of fathers.
Back when I was a child, before life removed all the innocence, my father would lift me high, and dance with my mother and me, and then spin me around till I fell asleep. Then up the stairs he would care for me, and I knew for sure I would love if I could get another chance, another walk, another dance with him. I'd play a song that would never ever end. How I love, love, love to dance with my father again. My mama would disagree, yeah. To get my way, I would run from her to him. He'd make me laugh just to comfort me, yeah. Then finally made me do just what my mama said. Later than now, she'd never dream that he would be gone from me. If I could steal one final glance, one final step, one final dance with him, I'll play a song that would never ever end. How I love, love, love to dance my father again. Sometimes I listen outside her door, and I give her mama back to you. I pray for her even more than me. I pray for her even. I know I'm praying for much too much, but could you send back the only man she loved? I know you don't do it usually, but dear Lord, she's dying to dance with my father in honor of the day.
Psalm 22. I'm not going to read that entire psalm for you, but I want to give you a thought for today. The same God, a great father. The same God, a great father. In the movie, The Pursuit of Happiness, Chris Gardner, played by Will Smith, is a San Francisco salesman who's trying to raise his son alone after the girlfriend leaves. Anybody saw that movie, The Pursuit of Happiness?
Yes.
He goes through a period of not making any sales, thus making him and his young son, Christopher, homeless. However, he continues to ask Christopher to trust him and believe in him. This is the only father that Christopher has, and he thus is willing to put his faith and trust in him. Some of us have got to put our faith and trust in somebody on today. I believe we need to come to the resolve. We need to trust someone. We aren't able to do it by ourselves. Here we see in this movie, this father had gotten frustrated. He had gotten weary. He even had to shed a few tears. Does any father know about shedding some tears on today? Any father figures know about shedding some tears on today? Anybody know about how life will frustrate you, how life will tend to kick you, how life will get you down, how life will bring tears to your eyes, even in your own private moments, and make you wonder, will you survive? You see, time is out for play for those who are parents on today. When you got kids that you are responsible for, playtime is over. When you got a family that you're responsible for, joking and jiving time is over. When you got people counting on you, depending on you, believing in you, and putting their trust in you, irresponsibility is over. You got to stand tall, be strong, and walk with power, even when you feel like you don't have any. Because everybody is looking towards you and counting on you. So the question becomes, where in life have you gotten stuck, let down, or disappointed? Might it be time to stop trying to go it alone and join with the one who has all power in his hands?
Wow.
In the movie Pursuit of Happiness, there was a higher power that Will's character, in my belief, had to lean on and submit to. This strong belief and persistence that was within him, however, is what showed his son as he tried to work on becoming a stockbroker. Y'all remember that part? Wow. He showed his son what his dream was. And while he was working on his dream, he was selling medical machines to get by. At some point, fathers have to let their sons and daughters know that they too have dreams, but there is a higher power that sometimes you got to trust in order to realize that dream. Amen. The Bible says our fathers trusted you in this psalm, in Psalm 22. So David lets the Lord know there is something to his power, because those who are wiser than him and those who are more mature than him and those who are father figures, they put their trust in him. They put their trust in God. As a father, whoever you trust in, whoever you depend on, wherever you say that your power comes from, you got to know that's who your children will follow. So fathers, if you want your kids to follow God, then I came to tell you, you need to follow God. I want to propose to you that mature men don't mess with God. Mature men don't mess with God. I know y'all say, Bishop, what you mean by that? After you experience some things in life, it will mature you. After you have enough shortfalls and dismays, you will grow up very quickly. When life knocks you up against the wall and your life is turned upside down, you'll begin to see things a little differently. That's why people say life's experiences are the best teacher, to help you mature. Some men have to mature the hard way, from what I've observed over the years, because their heads are hard and because they won't listen. But some men have to mature the hard way before they understand who they are, before they understand the power that they have, before they understand the source that they are connected to, and before they understand how to properly access and use their source. I believe once men get a true understanding of who ultimately has all power, just as David had to get an understanding, they won't mess with God. When I say that, I'm talking about you thinking you've got the power to turn your situation around. I'm going to bring this around for y'all. When I say that, I'm talking about you thinking that you have the power to save your family or save your friends or save your community. I'm talking about you thinking that you have the power to deliver your kids out of their addictions or spare your mother from the heartache and pain that you see is coming down the pike. I came to tell somebody today, God is the one with all power in his hands. But let me help you. Men sometimes think they can save the world. Anybody know any men like that on today? Think that they can save the world. Men think they can fight and win any battle. Men think they can move mountains and cause everybody to respond to their command. I think sometimes men, first they may have watched too much Tarzan, too much Batman, too much Superman, and Spider-Man in their younger boyhood days. Because we must understand that God is the one that has power to move mountains out of your way. God is the one who has the power to fight every battle and come out victorious. God is the one who has the power to speak, and everything must respond to his command. I'm just helping y'all today. God is the one who has the power to declare something out of nothing. God is the one who has the power to look and think about something and then it shows up and manifests in the earth. Church, God has all power in his hands, and that's why the fathers of all trusted in the Lord. They knew with God there is nothing that you cannot do. But without God, you will not be successful. So that's why I say mature men don't mess with God. They simply surrender themselves to him. Somebody needs to hear me today. Mature men don't mess with God. They simply surrender themselves to him. And I tell you, when you surrender yourself to the Lord, that's when you man up. We like to use that term, man up. That's when you man up and you know everything is going to be all right after a while. Somebody needs to get that on today. David goes on to tell the Lord in Psalm 22, he says, our fathers trusted you and you delivered them. Here David lets us know that God and God alone moves on our behalf. We sometimes think it's our boy, because of his position, who moved on our behalf, and that's how we got the favor that we got. We think it's our uncle, our grandfather, our brother, or our cousin, because he knew people in the community. He knew people in different positions. We think it's them who helped us get the job we got, helped us get the loan we got, helped us get the car we're driving, or even the house that we live in. Somebody needs to wake up and realize that everything you have is because of the Lord. Doesn't matter who God used to get it to you. It just matters that he made a way and it came to you as you prayed for it too. I'm going to have to say this a little differently because everybody didn't get it. God uses friends. God uses neighbors. God uses family. God uses church members. God uses school colleagues. God uses bankers. God uses car dealers. God uses builders. God uses strangers. God even uses enemies to get your blessing to you. So don't get caught up in who brings it to you. I just need you to get caught up in the fact that you got it and who God decided to use to get you your blessing. I want to suggest to you on this Father's Day that his hand needs to handle your situation. Yes. In the pursuit of happiness, the reason that Will Smith or Chris Webber was able to make it into the homeless shelter with his son, when all of those people were standing outside in the line waiting, y'all remember if you saw the movie, the reason they were able to get in was because of God's hand that moved upon his situation. The reason no one hurt them or killed them the night that they slept in the bathroom or of the subway train station was because of God's hand that moved upon their situation. The reason he was allowed to interview for the stockbroker training program job with paint all over his face, a dirty looking t-shirt, looking hot and sweaty, was because of God's hand that moved on his situation. If y'all didn't watch it, y'all need to go back and see it. Now, church, we must realize that there is nothing that God cannot do for his people. David, because of God's hand, was able to slew the giant Goliath. David, because of God's hand, was able to slew thousands in battles. They even sang songs about what a mighty warrior David was. David, because of God's hand, was spared and not killed by King Saul every time he went into a rage and wanted to take David's life. Yeah. David, because of God's hand, I'm talking about God's hand now, y'all ain't hearing me, was anointed king and was able to bring all kingdoms together, provinces, and made them together as one. David, because of God's hand, was one who prays like none other and experienced the power and presence of God every time he went before the Lord. Somebody in here today, I'm just crazy enough to believe, because of God's hand, was spared from a car accident that might have taken you out of here. Somebody in here, because of God's hand, was spared from a rape situation that might have destroyed your spirit and your mind forever. Somebody in here today, because of God's hand, didn't die on the operating table when they had you in surgery and didn't really know what to do, but God's hand moved on your behalf. Church, if you will trust in God, don't try to handle life situations on your own. I promise you, God will handle them. If you step out of it and understand you don't have any power anyway to do anything, then I tell you, God will handle it. The problem I see with many of us, men and women alike, is that we always tend to step in God's way. We get in God's business. We try to tell God what God needs to do and how God needs to handle it. Since we know everything and since we can do everything, I've seen God step out of it and allow us to do it on our own. Some of y'all can testify that your situation didn't turn out the way you thought it would with you being in control. Some of y'all can testify that the situation even got worse once you took control of it and God stepped out of the way. And so you had to come right back around to God and tell God that you were now getting out of the way. You were stepping out of it and you needed God to fix it. Anybody ever had to say, fix it, Jesus, fix it, Lord. Fix me, Jesus, fix me, Lord. I'm just crazy enough to believe that once you mature, you realize who has all power and who doesn't have any power. You realize you need your situation fixed by the one who's got more power than anything and everything you've ever known or seen. I'm just crazy enough to believe that you'll step out of the way and let the Lord do it. You will allow God to handle your situation and you will see the blessings begin to overflow in your life. Somebody needs to step out of it today. Somebody needs to get out of it today. Somebody needs to step back and say, God, step forward. Somebody needs to say, fix it, Jesus. Fix it for my good. At the end of the movie, Pursuit of Happiness, the father, Chris Webber, which was played by Will Smith, takes the exam to become a stockbroker. And passing the exam did not guarantee that he would be the one chosen for the program, but you had to pass to be considered for the open position. Will Smith studied and made the highest score on the exam. The executives called him into the office and told him he had the job. Yeah. He had worked hard, he had done well, and they wanted him to come on board and work for their company. Will Smith had now accomplished his dream and his goal. Yeah. But more than that, he had shown his son that having happiness was a reality. And he had shown his son that dreams can come true. Yeah. Will Smith demonstrated that, well, the way I like to say it is that things will work out after a while. David, who trusted in the Lord, gave all credit to God for things working out after a while in his life. The Bible says, and he said here, and you, meaning God, delivered them. When we look at delivered means free, out of your circumstance. So if you ever needed to know that God can do it, I need you to know now that all you got to do is just wait on the Lord. And the people of God saying, be of good courage and know that he will strengthen your heart as you watch him work. Lastly, I want to propose to you before I take my seat that victory comes from the Lord. Now, I don't know about anybody else, but every now and then, I need the Lord to deliver me and to fight my battle. I'm not in the battle every day, but when I do get in one, I need the Lord to deliver me. Anybody ever needed the Lord to fight your battle? Every now and then when I'm sick, I need the Lord to heal me. Anybody ever needed the Lord to heal your body, heal your mind, or heal your spirit? Every now and then when I've lost my way, I need the Lord to guide me. Anybody ever needed the Lord to guide your feet and direct your path? Because when he guides you, you're sure to end up at the blessing. Church, victory comes from the Lord. When we look at David here, David had been given victory many times by the Lord. But I think it's something to shout about when you realize that the same God that delivered you before is the same God that can deliver you right now. That's probably why David was always shouting and praising God. I decided to look a little further on this Father's Day. And I want to tell you, the same God that you serve is the same God that your ancestors served. The same God that delivered you is the same God that delivered your ancestors. The same God that saved you one Friday, saved you one Saturday, saved you one Sunday morning, is the same God that saved your ancestors, and the same God that brought healing in their lives. The same God that is opening doors for you right now and gifted you like none other is the same God that gifted your ancestors and brought them through their trials and tribulations. The way I see it, church, that's a reason to give God praise. Let me see if I can put it another way, because it's kind of quiet in the building today. When your testimony is that the same God brought my daddy out of his trials and tribulations, he delivered my granddaddy from his struggles and sorrows. He saved my uncle from his habits and addictions. He healed my brother and changed my son. When you think about all that the same God has done for your fathers and their fathers and their fathers, your soul ought to cry hallelujah, hallelujah to the Lamb of God. I believe that's why Jesus was always about his Father's business. He knew how great his Father was. He knew the power his Father had. If you're about anybody's business, church, it ought to be the Lord's business on today. If you want to man up, church, you want to be about the Lord's business. You want to be like David and be about the Lord's business. I don't know about you today, church, but God's been too good to me for me not to be about his business. Success.